The following presentation is brought to you by The Realm Network.
Today on Mr. Media, I'll talk to ventriloquist Jay Johnson, whose Tony Award-winning Broadway show, The Two and Only, has just been released on DVD for the rest of us. You might also know him as Chuck Campbell, the first ventriloquist ever to be a sitcom regular on ABC's long-running 1970s comedy, Soap, which featured another first, Billy Crystal as Network TV's first openly gay character. Stick around, and fear not. Ventriloquists are not a gateway to mimes. Promise.
Could be.
So much media, so little time. Who keeps track of it all? That would be me. This is Bob Andelman, and this is a Mr. Media interview, brought to you by Amazon.com, Audible.com, and 1-800-DIAL-DJs. Please stop by the website, MrMedia.com, click on our advertisers, support the show. And remember, there's more than 1,000 interviews available at MrMedia.com. We've been doing this since February 2007. Hope you'll find something you like. And thanks for listening. Mr. Media is recorded live before a studio audience full of carefully trained ventriloquists and their ghosts, including Edgar Bergen, Waylon Flowers, Sherry Lewis, and Paul Winchell, who will ensure that no dummies or Jeff Dunham are harmed in the making of this episode. In the new media capital of the world, St. Petersburg, Florida. If you watch only one Tony Award-winning video that encompasses the history of ventriloquism this year, make it Jay Johnson's The Two and Only. Now, I know what you're thinking, some of you anyway. Ventriloquism. Blah! But hear me out. First of all, if you're a TV fan of a certain age, say mine or older, you will recognize Jay Johnson from his role as Chuck Campbell on the long-running late 1970s ABC sitcom Soap. It also starred Billy Crystal as primetime's first major gay character and Jay Johnson as its first ventriloquist. Now, we've had a lot of gay characters on TV since then, but not another recurring ventriloquist character to the best of my knowledge. Now, in The Two and Only, which was originally conceived for and performed on the Broadway stage, Johnson goes to laugh-out-loud extremes to detail the early days of ventriloquism. Now, imagine someone throwing his or her voice during the Dark Ages. And eventually, he intertwines the industry's history with his own. I've had my own fascination with ventriloquists since I was very young, watching Paul Winchell and Jerry Mahoney on a black-and-white TV as a boy, and later discovering through my grandfather old-time radio episodes of Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy. So I don't know about you folks, but I'm really going to enjoy this, and I'm doing this interview for me. If you enjoy it, that's a bonus. Jay Johnson, welcome to Mr. Media.
Hey, Bob. Nice to be here. Thanks for that nice introduction.
My pleasure. Great to have you. I mentioned to you earlier that I'm old enough to have watched Soap unfold week to week on live TV. It was a must-watch TV in my home as I moved on to college, and so it's fun to see you. And what I'd like to know is why don't you? I mean, I'm like 35 years older. Why aren't you? What's the deal?
I have Bob aging in the closet. That could be added. That's how that works. So, it's funny. Soap was kind of a hip show. You know, people, you were very young when it started, obviously. And so young people were coming up all the time, my age, going, wow, love the show. And now those same people are coming up and say, love the show. My grandmother, plays it for me. You know, my grandmother has all the DVDs. So, yeah, we've had to adjust in 35, 40 years. Yeah.
We forget. I mean, I don't forget, but I think a lot of people forget or not even aware how groundbreaking that show was at the time.
It's come so fast so far that it's really hard to believe that, in terms of eons of time, 30 years ago, 70s, not that long ago, but in terms of what we can do and where television is, just a weird example of television. Jerry Seinfeld, when they did their last show and it was big ratings, their show did not have the rating share that Soap did when it was taken off the air. simply because you've got ABC, NBC, and CBS at the time. So if you were, if you had any audience at all, you were a third of that pie. Now, gosh, there's how many hundred stations and internet and everything else. Hard to draw anybody with those kind of numbers. So that's just one of the ways it's changed, you know, just availability.
Well, I'm going to come back. I want to come back to talk about soap in a few minutes.
Sure.
A little later. I've got plenty of questions and curiosity about that. But first, a simple test, if you will.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Spell ventriloquist.
Oh, easy. VENTRILOQUIST.
Okay.
And I'm dyslexic, so I had to learn that. I had to do that. I had to stay home and learn that one.
That is something we learned about you on the show, and I just thought, let me just make sure I have the real Jay Johnson.
Well, yeah, got to ask me a word that's less complicated and less used by me to get the spelling correct.
All right.
But the deal is that ventriloquism is a Latin-based word, so those are root Latin words, ventre and loqui, so... It's going to be hard for anybody that didn't grow up in ancient Rome.
Well, let's talk about the show. The two and only. How hard was it to get a one-man, multiple-dummy show to Broadway? And had it ever been done before, not counting vaudeville? I mean,
you know, I know that the very theater I was in, the Helen Hayes Theater, before it became the Helen Hayes Theater, was the Little Theater on 44th, and Paul Winchell did his television show from there because it was a television studio for years. They did Johnny Carson, Who Do You Trust there. They did the Merv Griffin show there. A lot of shows in that little theater. So I know that a lot of ventriloquists brought their act to New York and obviously would do a show. And I wouldn't consider that necessarily a Broadway show. That would just be a concert act that they take into the show. So there have been a few of those, probably Sherry Lewis, probably Paul Winchell. I'd be surprised if Bergen didn't do some stuff in New York. But as far as trying to do a show, not that many. You know, not that many. And like any show, it was, if we'd known how hard it was, we probably wouldn't have started. You know, we stayed home.
Well, it's interesting, though. I had no idea that Paul Winchell did his TV show from there. That's,
isn't that amazing? Yeah.
That's now. Did you know that when you got that theater for the Two and Only, or was that something you learned later?
It was something I learned later. As it turns out, a lot of people are confused about what is Broadway and what is off Broadway, and that's actually for those who don't know, that's just a number of seats. You could be middle of Times Square and have a theater that was less than 500 seats, and it would have to be off-Broadway. So the Helen Hayes Theater is the smallest of the Broadway theaters, meaning that its capacity is just over 618. So it's a Broadway theater, but it's just perfect for smaller shows. And that's where we figured we needed to be rather than some huge place that would be very difficult to fill. But, you know, the more I found out up at the Helen Hayes, it was perfect to be there. Somebody actually gave me a ticket of Paul Winchell's show from that theater, and I just kept it backstage. It was perfect.
Love that show growing up. I mean, Paul Winchell, Jerry Mahoney.
Yeah,
just the,
yeah.
Oh, my God, I love that.
Inventive, very inventive. Paul was great, at least as an inspirational performer for me, because he wasn't just a ventriloquist. He was also a good actor. He could also sing. He could also do a lot of things. He was really a complete kind of entertainer, and very smart and inventive and clever, and you know, all the things you would want to be.
And in terms of mounting this one man, as I said, one man, multiple dummy mm-hmm. show, what were some of the biggest obstacles to overcome? Was it just the concept of doing this on Broadway, or you know, were there other aspects of it?
Well, I don't understand why ventriloquism has kind of this negative stereotype. I know in sitcoms and mystery shows, it's always very convenient to have the villain be a split personality, and a split personality could be a ventriloquist, I suppose. So there's a reluctance to even assign ventriloquism to entertainment. You know, it's not something that you wake up on Saturday morning and say, tonight we're going to go see that, you know. So I think that had we just relied on the fact that it was a show about ventriloquism and a concert act, I think we would have much more difficulty. But I decided early on that there was a lot of things that people didn't know about ventriloquism, including its history and how I got involved and why I got involved and why anyone would get involved. So we dealt with all of those things rather than just here it is. And so the characters that appear in my show appear for a reason. We always refer to them as the musical numbers in a musical. You know, we bring out a puppet that's like doing a song, you know, so.
I love the way it, I don't even think I should give it away, but I love the way the show starts off with can I say a voice in a bottle? I mean, can I just leave it at that? Let's folks just think Barbara Eden, okay?
That's true.
I'll give you that. And one of the things that's really interesting about the show is it's not just you doing like a concert of, you know, here I am with Squeaky and here I am with Bob. It is this history of
pay no attention to that.
Yes. Stop throwing your voice to the phone.
Listen, I'm telling you.
How much of this history that we learn from watching The Two and Only did you already know, and how much did you have to research to put this together?
You've
got to stop throwing your voice. I know. I'm already convinced
it's
you.
I wish I could stop throwing my voice. Excuse me, Bob. Yeah, there you go.
You spelled ventriloquist. You got the gig.
I can spell ventriloquist. You know, that's actually how it ends. That's actually how ventriloquist goes crazy. They call themselves on the telephone, harass themselves. They heckle themselves in the audience. And pretty soon they just have to go. But mine is just now electronic. But all of this stuff in the show is really stories that I knew, things that I knew about the history. It was really my interest in ventriloquism that led me to those stories. Now, in certain cases, I wasn't sure the guy who did the original courtroom scene of the 12 jurors and all the people on puppets, his name is Fred Russell. I had to find out that. But I didn't know he did that, and I found pictures. And so the research was more proof that the story was legit rather than trying to find a story. I just needed to have some sort of tie to reality to what I was talking about. And all the things were just my curiosity for ventriloquism and what drove me to find those things. Yeah.
Was there anything that you learned about ventriloquism that you didn't know already as you were putting the show together? I mean, I got to remind people, this is not you just getting up there and riffing for it's an hour and 50 more minutes.
Yeah.
It's a scripted program. It's got a through line. It's very well thought out. But it's, you know, well researched in terms of facts. So was there anything that you learned about the history of either ventriloquism or some of the, you know, better or lesser known ventriloquists that surprised you?
And I don't know that I found out anything about my art form that I wasn't least aware of before. And certainly the stories were those that were familiar to me. But I think the one thing I found out about doing The Two and Only was this connection that maybe ventriloquists have to their mentors and the people that have gone on before them, that we really rely on a historic foundation for doing ventriloquism. And I think that surprised me when talking about my mentor, Art Sieving, how he became such a part of that show that I thought we were haunted for a while. You know, there would be strange things happen at just great moments in rehearsal or something that you would know that somebody was letting you know, yeah, that's the right track or something. So for me, it was to find that spiritual center of ventriloquism that always knew was there, but I didn't know that I would actually feel it until we did the show.
And there are a couple of wonderful anecdotal moments in the show. Once we move past, you know, some of the ancient history of ventriloquism and reference the Dark Ages, and you know, you folks can just imagine if you were throwing your voice during that time, what would happen to you?
It was a wonderful time back then, and yeah, it really was. And in some ways, I always thought, man, I wish I'd been born in the vaudeville days, because you know, do all those theaters and you got on a circuit and you did it as long as you wanted to and it stayed good. But then I look back and I think, man, to be a ventriloquist in the Dark Ages, when you were looked at with some sort of mystic power or occultish knowledge, when ventriloquism was a secret, that might have been a fun time too, to be a ventriloquist. But yeah, you're right. Back when when there are no telephones, there are no telegraphs, there's no way for human voice to be human voice except coming from a human. Person that could play with that, pretty much a magician, you know.
Probably would have been fun for as long as you lived, which might have been short, depending on where you were throwing your voice around.
Yeah, that's the negative. Also, when I was fantasizing about being a vaudevillian, I ran across a ventriloquist's basically writer, what he needed in his contract when he got to a theater. And it was just some things to make sure that they, the puppets were stored in a place so that the rats wouldn't eat the wood.
Jeez.
And I thought, you know, maybe I romanticized vaudeville, you know. I don't want to have to worry about that.
One of these anecdotes that I was referring to, it's a real formative moment for you in terms of helping you figure out your path, is you're visiting your, as I think you put it, your girl cousin. And
she
has this doll that she thinks is broken, and you've managed to fix it. Is it too much to ask for you to share that story?
Oh, not at all. It was my cousin Judy, and Judy came from the uncle who was the very rich insurance salesman. So she always had the toys that were of the moment, and that decade, that 4 or 5 years, I guess, was Jerry Mahoney. You know, Paul Winchell had put out a really nice little Jerry Mahoney puppet that was workable, you know. And Judy had that, but it was just a doll to her at that point. And so I saw it on her shelf, and I had wanted one of these puppets for such a long time, and my folks couldn't buy it for me because I say in the show, you don't buy a doll for a boy from Texas, you know. So I didn't get it. But when I saw Judy's, I just asked her if I could play with it, and I knew exactly what to do with it. I knew exactly what it was for, and I had been doing voices without that puppet for so long. So it was an instant rapport. I instantly knew. And she did. She thought it was broken because she couldn't make it talk, but I made it talk, therefore I had fixed it. So, yeah, it was a great thing.
It was great. And so at this point, I have a little bit of a surprise for you. I borrowed a friend. Hang on.
Oh, there's Mortimer. There's Mortimer.
Let me just make sure I keep him in frame. Okay. So
I think this is the same company that built the original Jerry Mahoney's. I think Mortimer and Charlie have been perpetual puppets. And the one I worked with had an actual stick. You could actually turn the head as well as just pull the string in the back.
Well, and so, I want to give credit where credit is due. We had our street had a garage sale on Saturday, and my neighbors, Roy and Vicky Meredith, they had put two of his apparently massive collection of ventriloquist dummies out for sale. And one sold, and Mortimer didn't. I think he's got a nicer Mortimer. This is as you mentioned, more of a commercial
toy. This is more of the doll, but yeah, that, you know, there's a bit, you know, there's something about a doll with a moving mouth. I'm a sucker for it, you know.
Now, are you able, this is weird, but if I work him, are you able to make him speak from a distance? I mean, you're in Encino, California. I'm in St. Petersburg, Florida. Is there anything that
Now, the main thing is coordination, because I can't physically touch him there. So let's see. If you break down the word hello from Encino, it would be hello from Encino. So it'd be done, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So when I put up my finger like this, you you do those six times, and I'll see what we can't do here. And I'm trying to think. I've never done a great Mortimer voice, so he's probably going to do an impression of Bob. How's that?
All right,
here we go.
Oh, hello from Encino, California!
A little stutter at the end.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
Yeah, very good. Put your hand over his mouth, Bob. Put your hand over his mouth. Yeah, just like that. Like that. No, no, no. It'll be okay. He'll take his hand down.
Okay.
All right. Thanks. You're welcome. Anytime.
All right. More.
I don't know if I've ever heard. That's the furthest I've ever thrown my voice. I'm, sure. I'm just sure.
All right, Mortimer, thank you for helping us out here. I'm going to set you back here for the duration of the show. And I, again, want to thank my friends Roy and Vicky for the loan.
That's great.
I
would be anxious to see Roy's collection. He sounds like he's a dilettante.
Yeah. I think what I might do is go over there later and take some photos, and share them on the show, and maybe send them over to you. And I'm going to share with him the DVD when we're done.
Oh, good, good. Yes, so please.
I thought that was fair. And apparently, this will be a surprise to Roy that I have him. Vicky didn't ask him; she just told me I could take him. So I said,
so "You may have more surprise than you think."
Yeah, I said I want to go with the least financially valuable that he has. But man, you'd be impressed by his collection. I was astonished. I'd never really noticed they're everywhere. So anyway, thank you for that.
What fun. As I said, I if there's a Guinness World Book that's looking, I think we just set a record there, Bob.
That's good. It's just about 3,000 miles.
I think that's pretty good.
I think that's good. All right. So there's the other really important milestone, I think, in your life is when you meet Art. Is it Art Sieving? I'm sorry.
Art Sieving, yeah.
And just to kind of set this up, you are at this point where you want your own dial. You want someone who's special to you. You've always kind of pictured who it was, and you go out and you talk to a lot of people who purport to build these things, and you're not seeing what you want. And then you come upon this older retired ventriloquist, and what happens here?
Well, you know, again, things have happened so quickly and changed so fast. When I was looking for a professional ventriloquist puppet, it's not a matter of going online and, you know, looking up and having 50 options before dinner time. This was a matter of finding somebody who had a list and then getting that list and then sending off. And then maybe hearing back, maybe not, maybe getting a catalog, maybe getting pictures. So it was a 6-8 month process. But every time I would get a picture of a puppet, it just wasn't, there just wasn't life to it. And if it didn't seem like it would live to me, I didn't feel like I could make it live for somebody else. And really the last carver puppet maker that I went to was a guy named Art Sieving, because they were alphabetical and the S was toward the bottom. And he was retired. He really didn't do this professionally to the extent that he'd carved more than 4 or 5 for his own benefit. And he didn't know how I got his name, because he never put his name on a list like this. So it was kind of an accident that we found each other. And at first, he just said no, that he just didn't do that anymore. And the longer we talked, the more we sort of had in common. And eventually, before that phone call, he said he would think about maybe making one more, but I should, you know, we should talk again, call him back. And so he sent me pictures of his work in the meantime with the codicil that, you know, you may not like what I do. You may not like my style, but here they are. And of course, they were exactly what I wanted, exactly what I thought they should be. And so I now have, at his death, I was willed his first puppet, which is in our show. And then so I've got the first and last puppets that the man ever carved in his career of making puppets. So, yeah, it was a magical connection. There's no doubt about it. And I think it continues today. Every time I do the show, I think Art's there. I think I think they see him in the film that we did of the show. I just feel his presence a lot.
Well, it's a wonderful way to memorialize someone that was important to your life. If people watch the DVD, watch the film, they'll get a genuine sense of your strong feelings for him and what an incredible character he must have been.
Well, he was, and you know, in reality, we shared letters a lot until he obviously got it was too difficult for him to write much, but. So over the years, there were less and less, but we shared letters. He wrote me every day while he was creating Squeaky, and we wrote back and forth. But I really was only with him for 24 hours, maybe. It was just one day in his life. Mm-hmm. But that day was so important, and that day was so full of just connecting on a level of human perception that we stayed friends forever. And just so many mystical, and I hate to use that. I don't use that word lightly. Mystical means something you really can't explain on any other level other than just a connection that's not physical, you know. And he certainly was the kind of ventriloquist I wanted to be, and looked at the art the way I look at it. And the fact that his name was Art, you know, it just goes on and on and on, really. Quick story. When I was with him at his house, we sat in his den, and he also made clocks. He carved clocks. And so he had several clocks around, mantel clocks and everything. And one of the clocks that really did touch me was a dragon clock that he had carved. And he told me how many chisel strokes it took for each scale on this dragon's tail that wound around the clock. And it was a beautiful, beautiful clock. And I had pictures of it. And while I was doing research for the show, I just Googled Art Sieving's name just to see if there was anything online. Died in 74, so I doubted there was much there. But I Googled him, and it said Art Sieving Dragon Clock.
Wow.
And I thought, I'm sure he didn't do too many dragon clocks, so I wondered if it was the same one that I'd seen that day. So I kept the links going, and I found a picture of that dragon clock, and I said, you know, it really does look like the clock that I remember, but I know that I've got a picture somewhere of me standing next to it, so let me see. So I go back and try to find that picture, and by the time I get back online to purchase that clock, it had already been purchased. It had already been bought. So I'm telling my mother this, and she says, how's the show going? How's the writing? And I said, well, in a disappointment, I almost got that dragon clock, and it just was bought right out from under me. And she said, well, isn't that strange? Because I bought it.
Oh, my God.
She was online and wasn't looking for Art Sieving. She, for a while, lived with on my brother's ranch in Texas, and they call it dragon bones. So she was looking for dragon things for the ranch. And dragon clock, Art Sieving. She said, that must be the clock Jay talks about. So it's in the family, and it sits now in my brother's pub that he built on the ranch that is called the Smoke and Dragon, and it's right up above the door. It has the perfect place for this dragon clock. But that was just one of the many kind of mystical ties that you say Art Sieving, and you get ready for something spooky to happen, you know. That's what it was about for me.
Now, I know that, because you talked about this, that you did sort of perform with him in the basement when all the dolls came together. What I was wondering, though, is have you ever seen any film online of him actually performing before an audience?
No,
any that exist?
I have not. There are a few pictures. Let's see if I've got a picture. No, it's somewhere. I've just found a new picture of him standing in front of a very strange background. I don't know if it was a club or what, that I'd never seen before. But I'm not sure that there ever was a film done of his work. But the way I remember him that day, we were just, he had three or four and I had Squeaky. They were about, I say that there was a room full of people talking all at once, and that's what it was. And he was just, his control was really special. I just thought he was the kind of ventriloquist I wanted to be.
Well, and okay, that's, you helped me lead into the next question, actually. I wondered, for people who, you know, they know about ventriloquists, maybe they haven't paid a lot of attention to it. How different is one ventriloquist, and I'm asking this rhetorically, how different is one ventriloquist from the next? For example, how different are you from Jerry Mahoney, is different from Jeff Dunham, is different from Edgar Bergen, let's say? I mean, I'm taking a big wide swath of history there.
Yeah, it's a fair question, too. I think it goes back to what we're talking about, this idea of ventriloquism and the creep factor, and we call it ventrilophobia, you know, and I'm not sure why we don't like ventriloquism, but some people just don't like ventriloquism, don't like clowns, don't like a lot of things. It's funny that you can see a singer, for example, and they could be any tessitura. They could be a tenor, a bass, a baritone, could be a soprano woman, could be any sort of singer, and say, wow, I didn't relate to that music. I didn't relate to that sound. I just didn't like that performance. But the next singer you see advertised, you'll probably go and say, I bet that one's going to be better. I may enjoy this one more. Seems like you see a bad ventriloquist and you think, that's it. I don't want to see another one as long as I live. But it's the same as a singer, a musician. Every artist brings their own personality to it. Everybody plays that instrument a little bit differently. So you can't compare two ventriloquists any more than two singers, two guitar players to violin players. And if you think, well, I've seen all the violin players I ever want to see, well, I think that's kind of short-sighted. You never know what you're going to see next. But, you know, I would say Edgar Bergen was not the best technician, maybe, in the world. His lips were not best technician, but as far as character and character development and acting and relationship to a character, maybe the best. And oddly enough, his skill set was perfect for radio because it wasn't really a matter of great technique. It was a matter of great diction and great character because you couldn't see it. So had he been more of a, Sherry Lewis had excellent technique, had been more of a Sherry Lewis ventriloquist, technically might not have been as good of a radio performer, you know, so you never know. Right skill at the right time is what we need.
Yeah.
But, you know, then television comes along, Paul Winchell and Sherry Lewis have to have great technique because they're being scrutinized, you know.
There were, as I recall, two very prominent ventriloquist performances in the 70s in pop culture. One uh-huh. was a guy named Jay Johnson on Soap as Chuck Campbell. And the other, and I apologize that I didn't look this up before we started, but there was a movie called Magic.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that
Anthony
was
Hopkins.
Sorry?
Anthony Hopkins.
Anthony Hopkins, that's it. Yeah. That was one scary mofo dummy. And I know from my wife, who will never watch that movie with me, it freaked a lot of people out. And I've often wondered if the view of what you do was perhaps different before that movie came along and scared so many people.
Well, they all kind of happened at the same time. As a matter of fact, the book Magic by William Goldman, mm-hmm. who had written Marathon Man, very good screenwriter and novel writer. About the time I arrived in Los Angeles, that book had just hit the market. And somebody said, you ought to read this book. And being a dyslexic, you have to tell me that there's something. And they said, well, no, it's about a magician and he does a little ventriloquism. And that's all I knew. So I waded through the book. And the minute I probably finished it at midnight one night and I closed the book and was in my manager's office at 8 o'clock the next morning with the book saying, they're going to make a movie out of this. That there's nobody in the world that can play that part but me. I was real, you know, like every actor is. But he said, yeah. And I said, no, there really isn't. I said, because I understand the motivation for this character. And I know it's a creepy book and I know he's a killer. But Goldman has found, for me, a real reason that would drive somebody that did this to kill. So my manager said, well, I'll look around. And he did. He found out who was going to do the film and what was happening. And at the time, Norman Jewison was going to direct. And they came to a little club where I was working to see me. And it was all excited. And at that time, they said, well, probably the financiers wouldn't go for you playing the lead. But they might go for you being the technical advisor. We'd give you a little part. You could always be on the set. And whoever we get, if you can just impart these ideas to him, maybe that. So I was very excited about that. As it turned out, that didn't happen. That director moved on. Richard Attenborough directed. They got Anthony Hopkins. And I never met those people and those people in that part of the movie. So, you know, it's the Hollywood story. I was this close to a part, didn't get it. But then Soap is there. And I auditioned for Soap probably within a month after that. And I got the part. So after I got to know Susan Harris, I said, Susan, how did you ever think of the part of Chuck and Bob? And she said, well, you know, I read this book, Magic, by William
really?
Ford, and I thought it would be a perfect killer for, and I went, yeah, me too. So I didn't get to do Corky, but I got to do Chuck. And I guess, you know, I picked got to pick the right one, you know, because certainly was it. But I saw the movie so many times. I thought the book was better than the movie, like many
yes.
books are.
Yes.
But during the movie, I was sitting in the audience, I don't know, I guess L.A. somewhere. And there's one section where Anthony Hopkins as Corky and Fats, his puppet, are dressed exactly alike. Well, that was a Chuck and Bob thing on Soap. You know, that was we always dressed alike. And even in the horror of the moment of the movie, I heard somebody whisper a couple of rows behind me, oh, my God, it's Chuck and Bob. And I went, yikes, you know, we've come together in a strange way, you know. So there were people teaching ventriloquism like home order catalog courses that thought the movie magic was just going to put them over the edge. Oh. They actually lost people. You know, people went, nope, I'm not going to do that anymore after that film.
I thought it was done great. I would think that was a tough time for ventriloquism. And so, which brings us to soap, kind of full circle here from where we started the conversation a bit. So Susan Harris has, Susan Harris, who I think later created Golden Girls, right?
And Empty Nest, and a couple others that didn't run quite as long, Madam President, and I don't know, quite a dossier resume.
Well, so she has these characters that are totally unique for the time. You as the ventriloquist, yes. And Bob as your very angry, very unpleasant ventriloquist dummy. Billy Crystal as a gay character who, very shocking on TV at that point. Was it someone who played your sister? I'm trying to remember who was having an affair with the tennis pro.
That was my step cousin. Didi Canova, who played Corinne, was having an affair with my brother Peter. Yeah.
And so,
his idea was to just kind of take these complicated relationships and characters of a soap opera and do them as a sitcom, And so we would get those moments of great pathos and sadness, and followed by something completely hysterical. And each scene didn't have to fit anywhere. Each scene was kind of its own little moment. So they could take two or three Chuck and Bob scenes and put them in two or three different shows, and kind of like a soap opera does today. They just kind of shuffle and put the plot kind of goes on so slowly. But she did find some stuff. And I have to say that they did not compromise on casting. They would recast 3, 4, 5 times if they didn't think they had the right person to do it. And so by the time you saw somebody on soap, they had been vetted, and they were, if that's the character they wanted, that's what they were going to get. They were very specific.
Did the cat, now you were coming to this not as an actor, as a ventriloquist and comedian, if you will. Did you get much respect from the cast and mostly the cast, I guess, who people you have to work with every day? Did they respect who you were and what you were playing, or did they treat you, as kind of an oddity?
Well, you get treated as you think of yourself. And I really thought of myself as if it had been a character that played the guitar and I was always carrying a guitar around, I still would have felt like an actor that played the guitar rather than a guitarist being an actor. And I just felt like I was an actor playing the part of a ventriloquist. The fact that I was the reason I got the job. Now, my character originally was just on for 7 out of 13 shows, so I was going to be killed off pretty quick. So initially, I don't think I was a threat to anybody, because they knew my time was limited. And, if we could get a laugh, and if you were in a scene with a laugh, that's all that really mattered. So if I had any problems, then I really didn't. It was just later when it became obvious I was going to be around a while. And with 17 regulars in the cast and always a guest actor or two, everybody was fighting for pages and words. And so anybody else that became a regular, depleted your ability to have a whole page of dialogue to that degree. But no, I felt everybody was great to me. Everybody was terrific. And the one thing that the director, Jay Sandrich, insisted on was that Chuck B, a ventriloquist, and able to do it live, because he thought that the actors then could invest in Bob in a reality rather than trying to loop it later or do it, as they do now, blue screen and all that kind of stuff. And I think he was right. I think everybody developed a relationship with Bob as they developed with me. And, I don't think they liked Bob very well, but I think I got along well,
And of course, I'm glad you mentioned that. People, they wanted someone who could actually do it. You had a little technical issue with the sound people.
Oh, my God. It's wonderful when you do some illusion so well that somebody falls for it. And then you're kind of going, wow, my God, they fall for it. How could they have fallen for it? And they go, well, that's what you do. But, first few days of my first show, they were not getting the sound that they wanted. They were not recording it well. And There was some question as to whether ventriloquism could be recorded, like some duck quack, you know, can it be recorded? There was a great thing I didn't know about. But they finally came down and asked me if I was doing anything, throwing it too far away, and I couldn't understand what they're talking about. Sound man, you know, that's their job, and they wanted good. So they finally figured out that it was the microphone being turned to Bob or turned to me or turned to me or turned to Bob. Sorry. And every time they turned it to Bob, obviously the sound went down. And yeah, so when we figured that out, it was everybody had a great laugh. But it was very serious when we couldn't record Bob's voice. You know, thank you very much. You have to go.
When you tell that story on the two and only, I just fell down laughing. I thought that was so funny because if I'm you, I'm thinking, okay, folks, I may be dyslexic, but you, Mr. Soundman, you're an idiot.
Well, no, he was doing his job extremely well. Well, that's what he always did, was make sure he hit the person talking. There was one time that I had to go back in and it wasn't on soap. It was on some safety film I'd done. And it was a song. We had to loop the song when they got the track anyway. So as you know, looping, you go into a stage and there's just a microphone and they play the movie and you kind of watch the movie and kind of do it. So the only one that could really see me was the engineer. The producers were there. And I didn't know what the looping session was. So Bob wasn't with me. And then I got there and I found it was just Bob's voice that we needed to loop. So I basically just stand in front of a microphone and,
you know, God just kind of talks like he would. And I was just sitting there like this, you know,
and they didn't know where the sound was coming from. So the engineer is trying to figure out what it is. And he would say, cut. I'm sorry. We have some technical. They thought they were hearing a track that was left over somewhere and they couldn't figure it out. So finally somebody said, you know, it's Jay Johnson and he's probably talking without moving his lips. And the guy went, okay. I'm just about
where we're done. Yeah. I love that.
Yeah, we fooled a couple of them. Yeah.
Jay, last question. Are you still touring? Can people see you live on stage these days?
Well, I hope so. You know, all the energy has been for the DVD, which will be out the 16th of December, and it's pay-per-view now. I'm hoping that will help people have a desire to see it live, because I do think it's a show that is best seen live. I think ventriloquism is a live medium. You know, I think that's where it is best. And my thrill is not as thrill as I get selling DVDs and watching, you know, pay-per-views. My thrill is doing this show. This is a story I love to tell, and I love to be out there doing it. So my number one priority will always be to get in front of an audience at a theater, any place we can with this show.
Great. Well, folks, listen, you can order Jay Johnson's The Two and Only. It's available currently as a pay-per-view. You can get it on demand on cable.
Yep.
Or in December, you'll be able to order the DVD, which is, of course, based on his Tony Award-winning Broadway show. In great bookstores or film movie stores.
Amazon.com has it right now for pre-order. So, you know, I'm saying those difficult Christmas gifts. Bob's your uncle in every sense of the word.
You gotta watch this. It's really funny and it's really entertaining and it's something you can watch with the whole family. There's an occasional word here or not, but you know, your kids have heard it. Don't sweat it. You can, of course, get it right here at Mr. Media at a great price. Website is thetwoandonly.com.
Yes, yes.
And are you on Twitter, Facebook, any of that kind of stuff?
I'm on it all. There's a Jay Johnson, The Two and Only Facebook page, and then Jay Johnson, just my page. Bob has a Twitter. I've got a Twitter. His is maybe smarter than mine, but, you know, being dyslexic, I don't read it every day.
There you go.
So, yeah.
Well, Jay, it was just a lot of fun and a pleasure to have you on Mr. Media, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Hey, Bob, thanks for having us, and this is great. And as I said, keep promoting the fact that you and I set the world's distance for voice tossing, and I know it's going to be hard for anybody to do better than that. So
that's got to be better than dwarf tossing, I'm thinking.
I do. I think so. Absolutely. So, nice talking with you, my friend.
Same here. Thank you. I have no issues with language. We've got nobody censoring this but ourselves.
Good.
And
well, you know, the language issue, it was one word that the FCC probably wouldn't let us say if we were, you know, a network show. But every time we go to a place, they say, can you cut that, you know, that word? We got Mavis and Kids. And I say, really can't. And I was the writer of the piece. I've tried every other way to make that point. And there's sometimes a word is the perfect word for the perfect time. And I've never gotten a laugh with anything but that word. So,
yeah.
So, and I don't think it's the word. I think it's the position of the character doing that. I don't know. I can speak a long time to that.
It was very funny. And so I just want you to know, you don't have to worry about your language here.
I generally am pretty respectful, but if I do have to just blurt it out, I will, Bob.
You know, I'm going on the assumption that Jeff Dunham will never do the show. And we'll start talking out of this as long as the dog keeps his mouth shut.
If I hear the dog, I'm going to claim to have thrown my voice. So.